By the name of Allah, the most gracious and the most merciful. Chapter 12, Capital Budgeting. My dear students, we discussed in the last lecture what is the meaning of capital budgeting, what are relevant and irrelevant cash flows, how to calculate the relevant cash flows, and estimating the cash flows. We are already classifying all cash flows as a part of one of the three groups, which are the initial outlay, the annual after-tax operating cash flows, and the terminal cash flow. We also take calculating straight-line depreciation expense and calculating depreciation expense using the MACRS, which is the Modified Accelerated Cost Recovery System. We also take VDB, which is the Variable Declining Balance Function. Today, we will discuss how to make the decision using six tools making the decision. Once the relevant cash flows have been determined, it is time to calculate the profitability measures. There are six commonly used profitability measures, which are payback period, discounted payback period, net present value, profitability index, internal rate of return, and modified internal rate of return. Financial managers have a number of tools at their disposal to evaluate the profitability. We are summarizing these six methods as follows. Let us look at the supreme show problem using this method. This table illustrates this procedure. At this point, we know that the payback period must be between 2 and 3 years, and that the remainder will be recovered during the third year. Assuming that the cash flow in year 3 is earned evenly through the year, we can subdivide the amount yet to be recovered by the cash flow in year 3 to arrive at the fraction of the year required to recover this amount. In this case, it will take 0.58 years, which is the result from dividing 14,184 divided by 24,248. Add this to the 2 years that we have already counted, and we arrive at 2.58 years exactly as before. We must set up a table of cash flows and a helper column for some preliminary calculations. In cells from C18 until D24, enter the data for period and cash flows. When entering the cash flows, be sure to reference the original calculations. For example, in cell D19, the formula should be equal B19, and in cell D20, the formula is equal $B$22, and so on. Finally, the formula in cell D24 is equal B22 plus B23. This slide shows the period, and we can use a series of if statements to implement the logic. In this slide, the if statement that we will use in cells from E20 until E24. This test is the sum of cash flows up to the current period to see if it is greater than zero. If it is, then we will know that we have passed the payback period. At that point, we can calculate the payback period as the count of the number of periods prior to the year of payback minus the remainder divided by the next year's cash flow. In cell E20, enter the formula equal if sum D$19 until D20 more than zero, count D$19 until D19 plus ABS sum D$19 until D19 divided by D20 minus 1. and copy it down to the rest of the cells. Notice that we subtract 1 so as to not count period 0. The payback period is the smallest of the number in cells from E20 until E24, which we can calculate with the minimum function. This function will ignore any true or false as boolean values that appear because we didn't supply a third argument for the if statement. In cell E25, replace the existing formula with equal minimum E20 until E24, and notice that the result is 2.58 years as we found in the slide in cell E26. Also, the payback period makes a great deal of sense. It is not without its problems. Specifically, the principal problem is that the payback method ignores the time value of money. You know from the discussion of time value of money, which we already taken in chapter 8, that we can't simply add cash flows that occur in different periods of time. Furthermore, it should be obvious that most investments become increasingly attractive as the firm's required return falls and less attractive when the required return rises. However, the payback period doesn't change when the weighted average cost of capital changes. The second difficulty with the payback period is that it doesn't take all of the cash flows into account. Because it ignores all cash flows during the payback period, it can lead to less than optimal decisions. Suppose, for example, that the year 5 cash flow for the Supreme Shoe project was $100,000 instead of $42,248. The payback period is still 2.58 years, which suggests that it should be accepted. But anybody taking even a close look at the cash flows would reject the project immediately. This second problem will be remedied when we look at the net present value and the internal rate of return and modified internal rate of return and profitability index. The discounted payback period. We can fix the time value of money problem by using the discounted payback period. This method is identical to the payback period except that we use the present value of the cash flows instead of the nominal values. Because present values are always less than nominal values, the discounted payback period will always be longer than the regular payback period. For Supreme Shoes, the discounted payback period is 3.53 years. Calculating this number is slightly more difficult than calculating the regular payback period because the present values of the cash flows are different in each period. For this reason, we must use the method and in the if statement to calculate the discounted payback period. Because Excel doesn't have a payback function, we have included one in the FAME fncs.xlam add-in. It contains a function called FAME payback that can be used exactly like a built-in function as long as the add-in is active. This function is defined as FAME payback cash flows rate, where cash flows is a continuous range of cash flows and rate is the optional discount rate to be used to calculate the present values of the cash flow. If rate is left out, the default discount rate is 0%, so this function will calculate the regular payback period. Be aware that the initial outlay, I mean the first cash flow in the list, must be negative or else you will get unpredictable results. All other cash flows may be either positive or negative. The firm paid back function requires a table of cash flows, which we have already created in cells from D19 until D24. Using the function to calculate the discounted payback period is a simple matter. Go to cell B26 and enter the formula equal firm payback D19 until D24 B17. The discounted payback is 3.53 years, which is longer than the maximum acceptable payback, which is 3 years. You should verify this result by hand. Notice that you could also use the if statement that we used for the regular payback, provided that you replace the values in cells D19 until D24 with the present values of the cash flows, or create a new range with the present values. The 3-year benchmark is problematic in this case because it was determined under the assumptions of the regular payback period. However, the benefit of the discounted payback period technique is that the acceptability of a project will change as required returns change. If the required return should rise to 18% instead of 15%, the discounted payback period will rise to 3.8 years instead of 3.53 years, and the project would be rejected. Because the regular payback period ignores the time value of money, it would still suggest that the project is acceptable, regardless of the required return. Try changing the required return in cell B17 to verify this for yourself. Notice that the discounted payback period still ignores cash flows during the period where payback is achieved. All of the remaining techniques that we will introduce are considered to be supreme because they recognize the time value of money and all of the cash flows are considered in the analysis. Net present value. Neither the regular payback period nor the discounted payback period is an economically correct decision criterion. Even with the discounted payback period method, we are ignoring cash flows behind the payback period. How then can the financial analyst make the correct decision? In this section, we will cover the net present value decision criteria, which is the most theoretically correct method. Most people would agree that purchasing an asset for less than its value is a good idea. Further, purchasing an asset for exactly its value isn't bad. What most people try to avoid is purchasing an asset for more than its value. If we define value as the present value or present value of future cash flows, then the net present value represents the excess value captured by purchasing an asset. This means that net present value equals present value of cash flows minus the initial outlay, which is means benefits or values minus cost. There are a couple of important things to note about the net present value. Most importantly, because value can be greater than or equal to or less than cost, the net present value can be greater than or equal to or less than zero. If the value is less than the cost, the net present value will be negative and the project will be rejected. Otherwise, the project will be accepted because the value is greater than or equal to the cost. In the latter case, the wealth of the shareholders will be increased or at least unchanged because the acceptance of the project. So, net present value really represents the change in shareholder wealth that accompanies the acceptance of an investment. Because the goal of the firm is to maximize shareholder wealth, all projects where the net present value is greater than or equal to zero should be accepted. Why does net present value represent a change in shareholder wealth? To see this important point, remember that any cash flows in excess of expense accrue to the common shareholders of the firm, Therefore, any project that generates cash flow sufficient to cover its costs will result in an increase in shareholder wealth. Consider the following example to illustrate this point. Hoy and Loi are considering the purchase of a lemonade stand that will operate during the summer months. It will cost them $100 to build and operate the stand. Because they have only $50 of their own as a common equity, they will need to raise additional capital elsewhere. Hoy's father agrees to loan the pair $30 as debt, with the understanding that they will repay him a total of $33 at the end of the summer. The other $20 can be raised in a preferred stock offering to several of the other guys on the neighbor. The preferred stock is sold with the promise to pay a $3 dividend at the end of the summer. Hoy and Loi would have to earn at least $10 in order to compensate them for their time, effort, and money invested. Assuming that the stand will be demolished and all capital returned at the end of the summer, should they undertake this project or not? The answer to this question depends on the cash flows that Hoy and Loi expect the lemonade stand to generate. Note that the weighted average cost of capital is 16%. This table demonstrates the three scenarios that are possible. Note that the required returns of each of the stakeholders is unchanged in each scenario. The only variable is the cash inflow after operating expenses and taxes. In the first scenario, all of the capital providers are exactly satisfied. Even Hoy and Loi get the $10 return that they have demanded. Therefore, the project is acceptable and it has a net present value of zero. Under the second scenario, everybody is satisfied and there is an extra $4 that goes directly to Hoy and Loi, the shareholders of this project. This is an example of a positive net present value. Finally, in scenario 3, the debt holder and the preferred stockholders are satisfied, but there is a shortfall of $8 that will reduce Hoy and Loi's return to only $2 instead of $10. Notice that in the last case, the return to the common stockholders is positive. They get back $2 more than they invested, but less than they require. This is an example of a negative net present value and will cause Hoy and Loi to reject the project. Returning now to our Supreme Show example, the net present value of this project can be determined by taking the present value of the after-tax cash flows and subtracting the initial outlay. In this case, performing the calculations by hand pose no greater difficulty. However, Excel can calculate the net present value just as easily and allow us to experiment later. At that point, we didn't make clear the misleading nature of this function. It doesn't really calculate the net present value as we have defined it. Instead, it simply calculates the present values of the cash flows as of one period before the first cash flow. It is vital that you understand this point before using this function. To use the net present value function for this problem, go to cell B27 and insert the formula equal NPV B17 D20 until D24 plus B19. We don't include the initial outlay in the net present value function. Instead, we use the net present value function to determine the present value of the cash flows and then add the initial outlay to this result. We know that the initial outlay represents as a negative number. The net present value is shown to be 27,552.24 dollars, so the project is acceptable. The profitability index. The beauty of the net present value is that it reports the dollar increase in shareholder wealth that would result from acceptance of a project. Mostly this is desirable, but there is one problem. Comparing projects of differing size can be misleading when a firm is operating with a fixed amount of investment capital. If both projects are acceptable and mutually exclusive, the larger project will likely have a higher net present value. The profitability index PI is a measure of the dollar benefit per dollar of cost. The profitability index equals benefits in dollar divided by costs in dollar. As included in the equation, the benefit is calculated as the present value of the after-tax cash flows and the cost of the initial outlay. Obviously, if the profitability index is greater than or equal to 1, the project is acceptable because the benefits exceeds or at least equal the costs. Otherwise, the benefits are less than the costs and the project would be rejected. The profitability index will always result in the same accept or reject answer as net present value for an individual project. There are two ways that we can calculate the profitability index in Excel. The most apparent is to use the net present value function and to divide that result by the initial outlay. In other words, go to cell B28 and enter the formula equal NPV B17 D20 until D24 divided by minus B19. This will give 1.4396 as a result, indicating that the project is acceptable. The alternative is to make use of the following relationship, which is net present value equal present value of cash flow minus initial outlay. Or by rearranging, we get present value of cash flow equal net present value plus initial outlay. Therefore, because we have already calculated the net present value in cell B27, we can calculate the profitability index by the formula equal B27 minus B19 all divided by minus B19. This method will be slightly faster because it still doesn't have to recalculate the present value. The internal rate of return. The internal rate of return provides a measure of the compound average annual rate of return that a project will provide. If the internal rate of return equals or exceeds the required return for a project, the project will be accepted. Because it is a measure of the percentage return, many analysts prefer it to the other methods that we have discussed because there are problems with the internal rate of return. The internal rate of return is the discount rate that makes the net present value equal to zero. An alternative but equivalent definition is that the internal rate of return is the discount rate that equates the present value of the cash flows to the initial outlay. Unfortunately, in most cases there is no closed form method for solving the internal rate of return, but it still has a built-in function that performs this operation. The built-in rate function in Excel will define or will find the internal rate of return for an annuity type of cash flow stream, but it can't accept a series of uneven cash flows. To deal with uneven cash flows, Excel provides the internal rate of return function that is defined as IRR values GAS, where values is the continuous range of cash flows and GAS is the optional initial GAS as the true internal rate of return. The cash flow stream must include at least one negative cash flow, or else the internal rate of return would be infinite. Why? Because solving for the internal rate of return is an iterative process. It is possible that Excel will not converge to a solution. Excel will indicate this situation by displaying num in the cell rather than an answer. If this error occurs, one possible solution is to change your guess until Excel can converge to a solution. To calculate the internal rate of return for Supreme Shoe example, enter the formula equal IRR D19 until D24 into cell B29. The result is 30.95%, which is greater than the weighted average cost of capital, which is equal 15%, so the project is acceptable. At this point, let us try an experiment to prove our definition of internal rate of return. Recall that the internal rate of return was defined as the discount rate that makes the net present value equal zero. To prove this, temporarily change the value in cell B17 to equal B29. Notice that the net present value in B17 changed to $0, which proves the point. Note also that the profitability index changes to 1 before continuing changing the required return back to its original value of 15%. Excel has a built-in function to calculate the modified internal rate of return. The function is defined as MIRR values finance rate reinvest rate, where values is the range of cash flows, finance rate is the required rate of return, and reinvestment rate is the rate at which the cash flows are to be reinvested. To calculate the MIRR in your Supreme Shoe worksheet, enter the formula equal MIRR D19 until D24 B17 B17 into cell B30. Exactly as we calculated earlier, the answer is 23.69%. In this example, we have used the assumption to make it is the same assumption that is implicit within the net present value calculation. But if you have other information that suggests a different reinvestment rate, then that different rate should be used. Thank you, my dear students.